You know, I'll just tell you what happened for me. I was lost forever with no hope and without God in this world. And Christ Jesus came, knocked at the door of my heart and compelled me to come be a part of his kingdom. And it was the best invitation that I ever had. And it's been the best celebration and party that I could have ever imagined. And it's living a life. It's called the abundant life. I'm so thankful. Without him, there is absolutely no way I would have lived the same miserable life, full of depression, sorrow, sadness, fighting, bickering, envy, strife, murder, and all the rest of the mess that goes on that everybody else who is without Jesus is living. Jesus Christ came not to give us an excuse to continue on in sin and be right with God, but he came and opened up a door so we could leave that realm, come into a glory realm of life, hallelujah, and righteousness, hallelujah. Righteousness is just right living. It's like living in love. It's the living the good life. It's the abundant life. It's the life. It's the eternal life. It's the God kind of life. You can live the devil kind of life if you want, but God has opened up the door that we may live the God kind of life. You may live the man kind of life if you want, which is really, I don't know. I'm not sure if it's above the demonic realm or below it. I haven't figured that one out yet, but somewhere in between. I'm here to tell you that Christ Jesus loves you more than you love him. I'm telling you right now, he's so passionate about you. When he does a service about you, he's dancing and hooting and hollering and shouting and rejoicing. But I'll tell you, he's so good because he just fills us up with his love and teaches us to walk in his love so that we can love him like he loves us. He spends a lot of time with mercy and grace. See, mercy, people think mercy is where you go ahead and justify the wicked. No, mercy extends to you an opportunity to change. Mercy extends to you and I an opportunity to get right. Isn't that good? And I tell you, I just praise God for every moment of mercy that I have received. Hallelujah. God is so good to us. I want to read a verse of scripture to you that so struck me. See, people put their trust in governments. They put their trust in social programs. They put their trust in jobs. They put their trust in their businesses. They put their trust, believe it or not, this is a hard one to believe, in their intellect. Hallelujah. Jesus, help us. Father, we thank you that we don't have to put our trust in any of the above. But all those things are coming to an end. And, I mean, governments will cease to exist. Charities will cease to exist. Social services will cease to exist. Your jobs, all the things that you kind of trust in, will cease to exist. Somebody said, when? When you breathe out your last breath. But they're also going to happen globally, universally, if you would, when Christ Jesus comes and sets up his kingdom. There was a prophet, a radical prophet. His name was Daniel. This prophet, when he lived, first of all, he was very unique. He was really dedicated to his studies. He was really dedicated to the pursuit of wisdom and knowledge because it was absolutely essential in the culture in which he came from. But there was also something else that he was really dedicated to. He was really dedicated to the name of the living God. He was dedicated to the promise that was given to Abraham. He was dedicated to a covenant. The Father had extended to mankind, and it started off with a family because Father could only find one man. It's too bad, but so many times God can only find one man. During the days before the flood, God could find only one man in his generation. His name was Enoch. During the days of the flood, God could only find one family, really one man, Noah. He identifies one man, Noah. But Noah was unique. He commanded his household. He told his kids what they were going to do, what they weren't going to do. He's unique. God could only find one man, Job. He could only find one man. When Satan came with all of his lies and came with all of his slander, God said, I got one man. And Satan said, listen, all the world follows after me. All the world worships me. God says, I got one man. God, Father only needs one man. Only needs one to preserve his purpose and his plan. Because I'm going to tell you right now, as it was in the beginning, it will be that way again. As it was in the beginning, it's going to happen this way here in the end. There's going to be a place where there is no more sin, ungodliness, and wickedness in the earth. Some people try to understand heaven and the ways of God and the things that are going to be going on in heaven. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, the reality of the things that your perception calls reality and that you're most comfortable with, heaven is far more real than that. Heaven has a reality beyond the perception of humanity at this moment. Heaven is a reality that makes this look like a dream. You know, when you're dreaming, you think, well, my, this is happening. But when you wake up, you go, wow, that was a dream. That was kind of a weird dream. Are you with me? There were so many things going on in that dream that it has no sensibility or logic to it, and I was believing it the whole time. On some other planet somewhere, you know, looking at a pink river or whatever. You know, some crazy, wild dream, and you wake up, wait a minute, that's just crazy. Well, because you just stepped in to a higher level of reality when you woke up. In consciousness. Well, heaven is far more than all of that. It's more than we can describe. It's truth. There's no lie in it. I you know what? No one likes a lie. No one likes to be told a lie. You go and you maybe invest all your money on a lie. You invest your life in on a lie. You believe something. You go on a hunting trip because somebody said there was deer out there. It was a lie. You spend all your time on a lie. Seems like it's so true. It seems like it's so real. The beautiful thing about it is God's come to remove all the lie and all the deception so that we can live in this truth and reality. Most people live in about 95% lie. Live in 95% lie. Maybe it's higher than that. Because when it comes at the end of the day, what have they been doing that lasts forever? What have they been doing that has real value? What have they been doing that has real meaning? I mean, it's one thing to go and read about the things that Solomon had revealed to him in Proverbs and in Ecclesiastes, where he sought out to understand everything that existed under the sun and discovered that it was all really a lie. He called it vanity and vexation of spirit. It's just all a lie. Men are experiencing and living their whole lives centered around something that's absolutely a farce. Look at them all running around thinking they're doing something. They're living in a lie. Christ Jesus kind of set us free from the mess. So we don't have to live under the impulses of hate and strife and criticism and debate and jealousy and greed. Man left to himself would have already destroyed himself. Do you understand that? You left to yourself would have already destroyed yourself. I don't know what your process of logic is, but I want you to understand. It's very evident that God divinely has intervened over and over again to preserve mankind. Of course, it got so bad at one point that God said the imaginations of man's heart is only wicked continually. And here's how God feels about imaginations that run wild with all kind of iniquity. And I think one of the great iniquities of today is the sexual abuse and immorality that goes on from young children all the way up to adults. And people just eat it like they eat it up and they pay for it in the realms of pornography and all these other areas. Just such iniquity, such vile wretchedness, so twisted. None of the beasts of the field are so twisted. None of creation so twisted as humanity's messed up insanity. And people sit around cozy in the lies and the deception of their own imagination, trying to justify such evilness, such wickedness, as though they'd done nothing wrong. But I'm going to tell you what God feels about wicked imaginations. He said, I'm going to destroy it. I will wipe it from the face of the earth. Somebody said, well, you know, there's not going to be any more judgment because there's no more law. Well, there's no law then either. There was no law. Moses' law wasn't even instituted for another 1,500 plus years. God, there's a higher law that the law of Moses just simply reflected. The earth cannot even bear the burden of men's iniquity. And men's sin and transgression, look at it. As it reels in its destruction. I think the first time I flew into Beijing back in, I believe it was 2000 or 2001, I can't remember the first time I actually flew into Beijing. It might have been earlier than that. So if you're writing this down, I'm not lying. I just don't remember for sure. So I said, you mean you flew into Beijing, you can't really remember? Yeah, because I've done it so many times, I can't really remember. You know, I've been so many places, I don't remember fully. But it was not too bad. You could see that oxygen mask would do you some good. It looked like coastal marine layer. But when I flew in the last time into Beijing in 2012, you couldn't see. Their visibility was maybe, I don't know, maybe an eighth of a mile. Maybe, pushing it. Oxygen mask was absolutely essential. I mean, the pollution, the contamination, just out of men's greed. Men in their greed feed you so much garbage. I mean, my goodness gracious, on the news, they feed you so much garbage in mass production of food. It just goes on and on and on and on and on. That's just the light matters. They manipulate you to be involved in every kind of evil thing and evil practice with their products. And what's really wild is God's people sit around and gobble that stuff up. Father wants you to have some wisdom. He wants you to have some insight. He wants you to have some understanding. He wants you to be able to see some things more clearly instead of constantly being hoodwinked, buying up everything that, you know, these snake oil salesmen have to sell. Daniel, having been given a vision from God, walking in such wisdom and insight, was able to see into the future and see the end of the way things are going to develop and then end. And of course, his wisdom was verifiable, his insight, his life was verifiable because he was set into a place in the highest seat of authority. Even though he belonged to the people most persecuted, a people more hated than any other people. People say, you know, they got all these various different skin problems and issues. Some people say, well, I'm black, and so I'm persecuted, or I'm Hispanic, so I'm persecuted, or I'm, you know, European, so I'm persecuted, or whatever. Well, the Jews were really badly persecuted, okay? They were bad persecuted. They were hated desperately. And Daniel, in that state, but because he walked in the wisdom and the anointing of God, was raised up to the highest place of authority to have the biggest impact of any single human being upon the king in his day and his generation. I just so look to God's people, so taking a hold of Father's wisdom and Father's understanding so that we too could walk in such a realm of divine glory. Daniel didn't even have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He just had a little bit of the anointing. And look what he did with it. I think that we in our generation run the risk of having more than anybody else ever had before, yet doing less with it. I think we run the risk of having more than anyone else before, yet doing less with it. Almost on every level. But, you know, if we can begin to understand divine principles, we'd understand then how was he began to move in such an authority in God. But one of the things that I'm going to talk a little bit about those divine principles here this morning. But one of the things that I want to point out is this. In Daniel chapter 2, verse 44, Daniel declared something that was declared over and over again since Cain killed his brother. so that he could have more for himself. And anybody was standing in his way that somehow caused him problems, he destroyed. And that's been going on ever since. Enoch prophesied these same things that I'm going to read to you here in Daniel 2:44. He said, "The Lord comes with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly, for the ungodly deeds which they ungodly commit." And I'm going to tell you right now, if you've got ungodliness in your life, I'm telling you, the wrath of God abides upon sin. I don't care what it is you believe. God's word from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21 declares this to be the absolute certainty. God has not changed. With him, a day is as 1,000 years. 1,000 years is a day. I mean, there's nothing. There's no changing with him. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's exactly right now the same as he was billions of years ago. And billions of years from now, he'll be exactly the same as he is today. In the eternal past, he is the same as he was right now. As he is right now. And in the eternity that is to come, he will be the same as he is now. Nothing's changed. He's all about life. He's all about what we call holiness. You see, the holiness of God is simply a place of otherness from all other things, contrary to the ways of life. You enjoy life. That life is just some little dimension, some little teeny fragment of a part of all of God's life. And whatever it is that you're enjoying about life, that's just a little fraction of all that God has in the realms of life. You enjoy the breath that you breathe because God breathed into man the breath of life. Somebody said, "Oh, no, he didn't. It was evolution." Listen, that is just, it's such a bankrupt theory. I'm surprised it went into the 20th century. And I'm telling you, we're talking from the high ground of understanding these things most perfectly. And yet men still hold on to some bankrupt, dead philosophy that Darwin even convinced himself of wasn't true before he died. Satan, doing whatever lie he can, it doesn't matter how illogical it is, how in every other evidence of science says it cannot be possible. The physical law says it cannot be possible. Newtonian laws say it cannot be possible. The laws of genetics and chemistry say it cannot be possible. Yet men hold on to some deceptive lie that has no logic or rational nature to it, simply because they don't want to have to deal with an almighty God. They don't want to have to be responsible for the way they live their lives, the choices that they make. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to be held responsible. You and I, all of us, will be held responsible for how we've dealt with this sacred thing called life. We live in a corrupt society where 62 million babies have been butchered. 62 million babies have been butchered for our convenience, offered upon the altar of our own pleasure. Somebody said, "Oh, well, it's the law." That is no law. That is lawlessness. At best, it's tyranny. And they're not going to come kill my babies. Come on, listen to me now. People are so bought into a lie. The person who started Planned Parenthood was all about genocide of a race. People don't even know that. Their whole mission was the genocide of a race. It's true. Go read about it. Go read. Go read. Go study it out. You know. People just living in a cloud of illusion and deception. Father came to set us free, came to give us the privilege to know the truth, to know how Satan is lying to us and abusing this creation that God fashioned and formed after his own image and likeness, and taking everything that is beautiful and holy and twisting it and making it something perverted. Satan doesn't come up with anything new. He takes that which is sacred and perverts it to destroy men's souls, to mock God, to lead sedition against him. And we pacify it. too many times and accommodate it. Instead of speaking out like Enoch speaks out against it, like Noah spoke out against it. God found one man, Abraham. He said, Abraham, I know, you know, that you're going to command your house. I know that you will command your house, hallelujah, to serve me. Because I'm telling you right now, listen, women, if your husband doesn't walk with God, forget about command, letting him command anything. You know what I'm saying? Hey, you don't want to fall in the same ditch. He's just going to destroy you like he's destroying himself. Don't listen to him. Don't obey him. Don't do anything but pray for him. Okay? Look at him. Tell him to get right. Love on him. Be gracious to him. But don't follow his leadership. Huh? Because he's void of understanding. And people want to quote the Bible at that point. My goodness gracious. The Bible has the context of the Word of God is that the man has over him as his head Christ Jesus. Well, good. Then follow that person. Otherwise, forget about it, man. Are you listening to me? Did I sound plain or was that kind of like politically correct? Truth. God's God of truth. And you know, Jesus laid it down with such raw reality when he looked at people and said, your father's the devil and his works you do. You know, people say homosexuality is genetic. Yeah, it's genetic, all right. They are of their father, the devil, and of his and his works they will do. It's a demonic power. People thinking that they were a man in a woman's body or a woman in a man's body is the same thing that goes on with the reincarnation thing. It's the same devil. That demon spirit knows and remembers the things that happened, I don't know, 100 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago. And they were in so-and-so, and they can come and bring knowledge and insight of historical events into a person that becomes possessed by them. It's a demon knowledge. It's a spirit knowledge, but it's the wrong kind of spirit knowledge. It's a demon knowledge. Demon knowledge is constantly convincing men of things that are not true. Lies. Deception. To live out your whole life in a lie is one of the great tragedies of human existence. Christ Jesus came to set us free that we could know the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And be liberated by the truth. Woo-hoo! That we could walk in wisdom and understanding and insight. That we could have the knowledge of the Holy so that we could be blessed and not constantly creating problems for ourselves. You know what? I'm just take a break moment and say this. You know, with what measure you meet is going to be measured to you again. And people love to hear that within the context of the positive. You know, if I bless the poor, is you know, it's going to come back to me heaped together, running over, you know. But I'm going to tell you right now, with what measure you meet in the bad area, it's going to come back to you again. And one of the things that people get more involved in than is amazing is speaking evil against other people with bad attitudes, defiled lips and tongues. Hearken unto me, children, I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desires life and would like to see many good days? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips. Quit speaking guile, doubt and curses, all these kinds of complaints. You don't know what you're talking about. Just look at yourself and say, look at yourself in the mirror and say, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about. Just look at yourself in the mirror and say, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about. If you would take heed unto the word of God, out of his mouth proceeds wisdom and understanding. You take heed to the word of God, you're going to be smarter than you have ever, than all your teachers. If you take heed unto the word of God, you'll find yourself blessed. There'll be no cursing. There'll be blessing. Hallelujah. Woo. Yeah. Bread is overrated. The word of God is underrated. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God, and to take care of every power of affliction and torment and hindrance that comes in your life. All I got to do is take heed in the word, because it's going to come back to you. You talk bad about somebody, and I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have all that bad on you heaped together, running over on your head, stopping you. Yeah, it's true. You're going to eat the fruit of your lips. Come on, people. Quit living a lie. Trying to feel better about yourself by tearing somebody else down. Don't do that. Are you listening to me? Bless. Come on, Satan. Don't get off in that pride stuff. It's one of Satan's biggest subtle lies. Don't get off in that arrogant stuff, that stubbornness stuff. When Father has life and life more abundantly, just blessing. Ah, hallelujah. 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 God is so good to us, isn't he? And there's too many good things to talk about the bad things, right? It's true. Just side note for a couple of people.
Hallelujah. Well, Daniel said, in the days of these kings, he's talking about the kings of the last day, and they're forming, and they're coming together slowly but surely, and there's remnants of what this ultimately will evolve into that exist even right now. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. Ha 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 ha. Strap your sword upon your side, Lord. Come ride prosperously. God, come. Trample out the grapes of your wrath, O God. Let your garments be as those garments dipped in blood. See, people think that Father's just high-fiving everybody. Get along, go along. I mean, he's not. Father's going to eliminate sin. The wrath of God abides upon sin and all ungodliness in every generation. And Father, through Christ Jesus, made a way that we may escape that. And empowered us so that we can live in a realm to where that we have understanding, insight to know what Satan tries to do with his lies and his temptation, to no longer be overwhelmed or overtaken by the things that he would try to do in our lives to mock God and destroy these things that Father has established. He says, in those days shall the kingdom, and in the days of these kings shall God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. Amen. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all of these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. I want you to look with me in a amazing verse of scripture in Job chapter 28, verse 28. And if you've never spent time reading Job chapter 28, the whole of Job is absolutely wonderful for you to just get involved in, because it's got great doctrine. It's just much of it is misapplied. It's misapplied to Job. Great doctrine. Great doctrinal insight. These men were men of renown. They were great men of wisdom and insight. They knew the Lord. It just was, they knew God. God knew them. That's proven in the book. And of course, you know, Job was such a champion for humanity. He's a champion for humanity like Enoch was a champion for humanity. He's a champion for humanity like Noah was, like Abraham was, like I pray that you will be. To do that, you're going to have to come out from among them. Be separate, says the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing. Father said, I'll receive you. To be a champion, you're going to have to understand how to depart from evil and depart from iniquity. You have to understand the power and the authority and the insight that the Word of God has brought to us in order to be able to do that. You've got to understand the authority and the power and the ability brought to us by the Holy Spirit to be able to do that. A fellowship and a relationship with God where you're hanging out with Him all day long. Instead of waffling back and forth between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of earth, the things that are sovereign, the sovereign will of God, and the things that have to do with your own will. Because people are constantly wavering back and forth. And that's going to impede growth in your life. It's going to impede those things that Father wants to produce in your life. But look with me in Job chapter 28, verse 28. And let me just kind of set the tone for you. Because what happens is Job begins to describe, first of all, that there is a vein for the silver. And, you know, that may sound like something that is just, you know, some theoretical concept about how to find a silver mine and develop a silver mine. No, no, no. That person that found that vein of silver was looking for a long, long time. And you usually find silver in very hot and arid places like Nevada. It's where most of our silver mines are. And when you find that vein for silver, you can go dig it somewhere else. You stay right there because now it's the mother load. That's where you're going to get it. If you want to get silver, you got to find the vein for the silver. And what
what Job is going to say. If you want to find the place of wisdom and understanding, then you got to find the source, the realm from which it comes. Where do you dig for that? And then you stay right there because that's where it's supplied. Do you want to find where wisdom and understanding is? And he builds up this whole, as it were, hunger within the heart, hopefully, of the listener. As he describes how God, through wisdom and understanding, created all things. He created rivers in the midst of rocks. He hewed out the Grand Canyon. He didn't need a glacier. And he goes on describing all of the various different dimensions of the physical laws of the universe that go on right now. I was talking to a person on the plane the other day. He's doing his PhD in statistics here at UCSD. And the people that he's been with in statistics are just like, they're the cutting edge statisticians of the age. And so he's recently given his life over to the Lord Jesus and argue with a statistician about probabilities. Argue with a statistician. And I said, man, I want you to go and I want you to become an expert at the anthropic theory. I want you to become an expert at the fact that when we take all known variables concerning creation and we put them into a statistical model, it says that man was created by design at every level. Yale, we're not talking about people who had an agenda to try to promote creation. They were just objective scientists at Yale and other Ivy League schools that got together on this project. And I said, I want you to learn it so well because nobody's going to be able to defeat sound wisdom ever. And especially when you can argue from the highest platform of probability within the realms of the world of statistics, because I'm telling you, the days of correlation have ended. They ended with computers. They ended with knowing more of the factors that are involved in all the various different functions of life. Some of you understand what I'm talking about. Some of you don't worry about it. Just let it go. I'm just telling you, there's a whole lot more going on than what you know. That's all. Than any of us know. The Father knows it. And when we look out in the universe and we see hundreds of millions of galaxies and we're still counting. It's like I told a guy from NASA not too long ago. I said, how long is it going to be before you guys are able to see the edge of the event? That is the outer limit of the Big Bang. He said, oh, well, probably be 5 years out. I said, you just remember, you heard it here first. You won't see it. It's bigger still. Because all creation reveals who he is. If science had time enough, all man would come to know that God is who he said he is. It's just you don't have that much time. God's given you a jump start. He said, just believe this and do it and you'll be safe. Believe this and live right. Live right. Because I'm gonna judge you for your wrong living. And then man gets proven to him that in his nature he cannot live right. And so damnation is on his soul. So Father in his love makes a way for there to be a heart change, a nature change, so man can begin to live right. Yeah, you know what? We live in a time where men will not endure sound doctrine, and that's why people come in here by the hundreds and leave by the thousands, as it were. Are you with me? Somebody said to me with a big church, how can we have revival? I said, just let some people like me come in. You'll have revival. There won't be hardly anybody left, but you'll have revival. There won't be, they'll get up in droves and run out to place. Because we live in a day where men will not endure sound doctrine. They have itching ears, and there are people here right now have itching ears. There are people listening to me on the web who have itching ears. You will not endure sound doctrine. It's just true. You know in your gut it's true. In the Word of God it's proven to be true. You won't endure it because it demands change. It demands radical change, and you've justified your state to the point that you will not hearken to the change. Listen to me. God created the heavens and the earth and all that are in them. How do you know? He said so. And I have met him, and everything he's declared that is observable has been reproduced and proven. The blind eyes have been opened. The deaf ears have been opened. The crippled have walked. The dead have been raised to life again. Hallelujah.
The Lord didn't just come and just have some, you know, great logical explanation of life and who we are and what God wants, and just said, believe me because I'm a professional. He came with proofs, with mighty signs and wonders, with evidence, with reproducible evidence. Hallelujah. Huh. And yet men still harden their heart. And I have to ask you today, are you going to harden your heart? So it says God is asking through Job, where is wisdom? Where is the place of it? I went to death, and death said, we heard the fame of it, but we don't know where it's at. See, you read through Job chapter 28. I asked the deep. The deep said, yes, we know of it, but it isn't here. We do not know where it resides. There was no place within the framework of that which men could discover in his world to find that which goes beyond the price of rubies and beyond the price of gold and silver and beyond the price of wealth and riches and beyond the price of everything that could be desired or obtained to better man's state. Everybody had heard of it, but nobody knew how to get it. At the end, Job says, I can tell you the place of it. I know where it's at. I know where you can get it. And he describes it there in verse 28. He says, but to man, behold, the fear of the Lord, the fear of the Lord, not reverential worship, yarat, the fear of the Lord, the fear to be in awe, to tremble, the fear to be literally terrified, knowing the terror of the Lord, Paul said, we persuade men. This fear of the Lord, this is the beginning of wisdom. And to depart from evil, that is understanding. So people want to have wisdom. They want to have insight into the future. They want to know how things exist. They want to understand how things work. They want to understand how things can be changed. But they won't depart from evil. And because they won't depart from evil, they have now left the place for wisdom to grow and mature and be developed in their life. Proverbs chapter 8, God sounds out the same message as he builds it up in chapter 2, chapter 1 and chapter 2, crying out to the sons of men, declaring to them, here's the place of wisdom. Do you want to have insight? Do you want to know how this works? Do you want to be ready for the most important event of your life? I'm telling you, people, there's something, reality's about to step into your life. Life is about, well, eternity is about to begin. It's about to begin. This is a time, a moment in your existence where you're making a choice about eternity. And God has laid the laws, and he's proven them, and they're reproducible, and he's not going to change. You better fear, and you better tremble, and you better recognize that a spirit of rebellion came across the world back about 45 years ago, and events began to change within the context of the church. Men didn't tremble in the presence of the Lord anymore. Holy Ghost conviction was somehow put off. People want to sit around and giggle rather than weep and cry out to God for repentance to become a reality in the life, for right living to be established in the life, to depart from evil. The preacher said in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, I believe it's verse 13, he said, the sum and total duty of man, the sum and total responsibility of men. Here is your responsibility before God. He gave you life. He gave us life. We came into this world. He said, here's your responsibility. He said, depart from iniquity and do that which is good. Father comes with his word, and he reveals his word at Sinai to show and describe to men what is good. Because men left to his own conscience had become so defiled that their imaginations were only wicked continually. Peter said of the last days, and he's really quoting things that are also quoted in Isaiah. He says in 2 Peter chapter 3, he says, having eyes full of iniquity, having eyes full of iniquity, having eyes full of adultery. Huh? He brings it right down to the specific nature of the sin and the immorality. Having eyes full of adultery, they cannot cease from sin. Does that ever speak to this age? Never in a time could such a scripture ever be fulfilled on this level. Having eyes full of adultery, they cannot depart from sin. They cannot cease from sin. The Lord says it's your duty to depart from it, to cease from it. Oh, Sakina Mala La Saterinea. Balam de Boserateya Payo. People, what we have to understand is this. We have to recognize the season and the time that we are living in right now. Recognizing that men will not endure sound doctrine, that they have all these various different excuses and reasons not to believe, to where they self-justify, to where they overthrow the Word of God with their lies, with their deception. And then we've got to begin to cry out to God that we can be an answer to that. We've got to be willing to understand that Father wants to raise up champions. We don't know how to walk. We don't know how to move. We don't even know how to start. We don't even know how to begin. But where we begin is an encounter with God. An encounter with God will produce faith. And faith, even though, you know, when you have an encounter with God and you know that you're supposed to begin and you know you've got a vision and a purpose of what you're supposed to be doing, you may not know the next step. But now, after that encounter, you have such faith that you're just going to start moving in that direction. And when you start moving in that direction, miracles, signs and wonders, provision starts happening. You now find yourself in the big middle of being able to bring salvation to a people who have been locked into a place of deception and darkness. What is it going to take for a revival to come, for an awakening to come? It's going to take passionate, radical people who are not busy doing other things. Who are not busy about their own well-being and their own bank accounts and their own wealth and their own stuff. The Lord tells us you're going to have to leave all that so you can begin. If you leave all that, you can begin. And then I'll bless you. I'll take good care of you. But we want to hold on to what we can do. We don't want to leave it. There's many people who never left it to begin anew in God. And that's every dimension of our lives. Let the Holy Spirit deal with you today. He's not come to condemn you. He's come to call you to change. He's kind of say, listen, I got a better way. I got a better plan. You're walking around trying with blinders on to feel your way through truth. I'm going to tell you right now, I want to give you the ability to see and understand. I want to be your light. I want to come lead you and guide you, but you got to hearken to my word, because where does wisdom come? It proceeds forth out of his mouth. Where does wisdom come? It comes from his word, the word of God. Tonight, I believe that the Lord is going to have me spend some time ministering on a particular subject, and you know, I'm going to use one of the verses of Scripture that I believe the Lord will have me minister on some tonight, because it's just so fitting right here. It's Colossians 3:16. Scripture says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. The people, his word is a light. I mean, how many folks, they just live their whole day. They don't go to the word. They don't know how to let their meditations be upon the Lord. They don't know how to let the words of their mouth and the meditations of their heart be holy and acceptable unto the Lord, because they live in their own meditations and they live in their own mouth thinking. To have his meditations, to have his word as your meditation, I mean, only thing that's going to be acceptable to God in your meditation is his word, truth, his ways. The only thing that's going to be acceptable to God in your mouth is his word. His ways, the declaration of those things which he's done, and he comes with his word. His word is living. We just think it's black ink on white paper. It's spirit. You begin to partake of it, and God supercharges us with a divine ability to step over into wisdom and understanding that then gives us the ability to depart from evil and depart from wickedness so that we can step into a greater wisdom and insight and understanding. And that's why James picks up the subject and says, listen, God will give wisdom liberally. He won't begrudge it to anyone. He's happy to make everybody have the same insight, perceptions, and smarts as he does. But he said, don't waver in your thinking. Diakrinos is to have two judgments, to dichotomize Diakrinos is the word for that we translate most places. Doubt just simply means to waver. Two judgments. Two judgments. God says, you get a nothing. The Lord says, if you don't waver, you know, the disciples were so amazed. What is Matthew 21:21? God is so good to us. I love that. I love his word. It says in Matthew 21:21, or 21:22, he says, the disciples having seen how immediately the fig tree dried up, when he said, no man ever eat fruit from you forevermore. And immediately they all wondered, that because immediately the fig tree dried up. I mean, it's green and living, and it immediately wilts. Looks like it's been dying for years. In seconds, it died. Jesus said, don't be a marvel at this. He says, all you have to do, if anybody, if you just believe, if you'll just move in faith, and you will not waver, you will say to the mountain, be moved and cast into the sea, and whatever you say, it will come to pass. Jesus opens the door pretty wide there. Whatever you say will come to pass. That's opening the door pretty wide. Somebody said, I prayed, yeah, but you didn't cease from sin. I prayed, yeah, but you didn't stop doing the things that causes a separation between you and God, where his face is against you and his ears are not open unto your prayer. Uh-oh. Now I can see them getting up in the masses, just filing out the back door, saying, I can't believe you allowed him to come in here and preach. Did you hear what he said? Ann and I was recently in Zambia, and we were talking about the healing power of God, and it's his will to heal everybody. And one of the preachers got all upset, him and his wife. Did you hear what he said? They went to Phil and said, did you hear what he said? He says everybody should be healed. And Phil looked at him and just said, I'm with him, man. So because he couldn't get anybody on his side, so he had to come back to the next meeting. So all of you just get somebody on their side, now they have a reason why they can now write you off. But when now all of a sudden they can't get somebody on their side in authority, now they got to sit and listen again. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know what happened resulted in that? His wife had had a back injury, had been in pain with back injury for something like, I don't remember how many years it was, 15, 20 years. The Lord instantly totally healed her. As soon as her husband got right, she got right, because she couldn't get right because her husband's sitting there all. I just stood over top of him like this and never looked at him, just stood there. He's so ugly looking, man. You just kind of want to pull out a mirror and say, look at that, that's pretty bad. Smile will help that look a lot. He comes to me and he says, I got to repent. I said, what do you got to repent of? He said, I used to move in the things of the Spirit long ago and I backed away. I said, we'll start moving like never before beginning this day. And he's just started going off, and right after that, his wife got healed. And you know, you ought to be careful the things you help people out with when they got a problem, because really, more than likely, their problem is with the Lord. Now you're siding against God with them. So that's actually an open act of rebellion and anarchy against the kingdom of God. And all you're doing, and you thought you were trying to just be sweet and sensitive to their need. No, you're an idiot. You're void of understanding. Huh? I mean, you got to be bad off mentally to side against God while you're wanting him to bless you. Amen? You know, here you're crying out, oh God, fasting and praying, going without food, starving yourself, torturing yourself, so that you can just have to know him more. Now you're siding against him. Once have I spoken yea twice, but now I'm putting my hand over my mouth. This is basically what Job said in modern English, modern terminology. I'm looking in the mirror and telling myself to shut up. You don't know what you're talking about. Hallelujah. Try it. It works. Look in the mirror and tell yourself, you do not know what you're talking about. So shut up and start speaking only the word of God. Just start speaking his word and believing his word and moving in his word and quit having two judgments about it. Hold fast to it. No matter what comes down, hold fast to the word of God. Don't let it slip. See, Abraham had plenty of time. He had two judgments, but he didn't waver. He's refused to have two judgments. Count of God what? Faithful, that's what. Hallelujah. You can't walk with God faithfully and not end up blessed. You listen to me. I don't care what storm, trial, problem you're going through. You just stay right with where God got you. You stay right believing what God said he would do for you. And you're going to succeed. You're going to succeed, man. You're going to succeed. I'm going to tell you right now, there was a time in my life where I said, Lord, I don't hate evil. There's certain things that are evil that I don't hate. Might as well just get honest. He knows anyways. But Lord, I want to learn to hate them. I want to hate them. I've accommodated them. I've embraced them and said it's not so bad. All I had to do is ask God to teach me how to hate evil, and he went right to work. Hallelujah. Instead of justifying, we all going to sin more or less every day, and God knows we're in this world, and devil's got stuff going on. It's better than what he's got going on. Satan's having a party, good time. God just sitting around being bored. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me? Come on, man. It's just so messed up. That is so stinking messed up. And that's the lie that Satan gets across to most people. And it's just so messed up. It's so stupid. Satan comes up with the most stupid things, and we believe it. Lord Jesus. Satan comes up with these ideas that death is good, and we buy in on it. Sin is good, and we buy in on it. God says, all who hate wisdom love death. I hope you're passionate about wisdom. I hope you're passionate about divine insight. I hope you understand that it's the word of Christ dwelling in us. If we allow the word of Christ to dwell in us, the spirit of wisdom, hallelujah, will rest upon us. And revelation, divine insight, understanding, the knowledge of the Lord. If we're just simply at that crossroads where all of a sudden the temptation's coming on us and we just know, we just got to do this thing. We think it's a desire and a need, an addiction, a passion. It's not. It's a demon. It's a demon spirit of hell. I pray, God, open up your eyes and you can see that ugly looking thing. That nasty thing. It'll scare you to death. First and foremost, you'd probably die of a heart attack. You're so scared to death. Because this is a horror story, the worst horror story ever, and it's come to life and it's inside you. Or it's messing with you. Come on, it's worse than a tapeworm. Come on, it's just, listen to me. If you thought you had one, you go get some help. Man, I got to get this thing out of me. Are you listening to me? I'm trying to break this down for you. I tried. At that crossroads, and you're just saying, wait a minute, this looks so good. It seems like I have to have it. It seems like I need it. And all of every time I have to have it, and every time I need it, doesn't really do anything for me, because at the end I'm going, why did I do that? But if that crossroads, I say, no, I'm not going to. I'm going to turn to God's word. Father, I want to do your word. I want to obey you. Strengthen me. Help me. What's happening is you're going to discover the vein for the wisdom. You'll discover the vein. Now just stay, keep digging. Don't go look for another vein. Stay right there, because it's a mother load. I mean, it's going rich. It's going to bless you richly. Now all of a sudden, those things that were obscure to you, those things that you couldn't understand, those things that didn't make any sense, all of a sudden your mind becomes quickened. All of a sudden you have sight to see, ability to know things that before you could not know them. God retains all rights to revelation. And if we're simply willing to be obedient to him and obey his word, he then unveils his word. He unveils his knowledge. He unveils his wisdom. He unveils his insight. And we go, whoa, Father, I see you. You high and lifted up. Now you're in awe. Now you begin to fear. The fear of the Lord is to depart from evil. It's the spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord, Isaiah said, rested upon Christ Jesus, the Messiah. With that, it was the spirit of the fear of the Lord, along with the spirit of wisdom and understanding, along with counsel and might, to have might, to be able to deal with spiritual wickedness, to be able to deal with principalities and powers, to be able to deal with the authorities that belong in the realms of the darkness and the demonic, tread upon them and be able to have authority over every work of darkness, to destroy it, to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, the spirit of might, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of knowledge, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of the fear of the Lord. Hallelujah. Sikanda boserena asheha. So Paul says in Ephesians, he says, be filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. And that's chapter 5, verse 18. Hallelujah. And then Colossians 3:16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. And in both instances, he says that the response and the dedication and disposition should be speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make a melody in your heart unto God. Worship Him. Live Him for His praise. His praise shall be continually in my mouth. Hallelujah. My soul shall make his boast in Thee, O God. Hallelujah. The humble. They'll hear there and be glad. And we're all excited and happy about the humble hearing and being glad. The prideful and the arrogant, they're going to hear thereof and be mad. Forget about it. You're going to have the fallout. You know, if you're just too fragile for anybody to be mad at you, you just want to make everybody happy. You're just a people pleaser. I can't ruffle any feathers. Ask God to help you, because you need help. Ask God to help you with the fear of man, and get the fear of man out and get the fear of God in. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ask God to strengthen you and embolden you so you don't need men's approval. Hallelujah. You got God's approval. You're not walking around so insecure anymore. See, it's a bondage of fear. It makes people insecure. And we've all had to deal with it. Every one of us. Because it's just in the atmosphere. You sit around and say, I'm so pathetic. I'm such a loser. You're not going to get nothing. Huh? You're not going to get anything. You have to say, here's God's opened up a door for me to come on in and get everything. He's God. And you got to come run in. The name of the Lord is like a high tower. The righteous run in. To trust in the name of the Lord. Not in chariots. Not in horses. But in the name of the Lord. I come not with sword nor shield. But the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, there'll be more to that tonight. I just don't like to stop. I stand out here and preach all day and prophesy. Get it to a point where I see people beginning to break, then come pray for you. Hallelujah. Run that devil off forever. Amen. Hallelujah. So I say, oh, yeah, we'll just tag team. Man, we'll knock him out. Now we'll cut his head off. There's no wrestling here going on. Hallelujah. End it. Amen. No drama. End it. She caught up outside there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Father's equipped you. Father's invited you. He's equipped you. He's empowered you. He's dedicated to you. He wants friendship with you, relationship. God created you in His image and likeness, and His likeness created, He created you. Emphasis. He wants oneness. Hallelujah. Not otherness, oneness. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. I beg you today to be accepted in the Beloved. I beg you, I beseech you today to be acceptable. To be holy and acceptable, because without holiness you can't worship God. And Satan's biggest thing is he's trying to keep people from a mentality and a state of acceptable. I'm living in the ministry of righteousness because Christ Jesus has made us righteous by His own blood and by His own life. He's made us holy. Hallelujah. Gift of holiness. Oh, Saturna, you can't worship God without it. You can't worship God with a defiled conscience. Satan's doing everything he can to keep man from oneness. Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, I beg you to become acceptable to God by Christ Jesus. I beg you to come, become acceptable to God by an acceptance of those things which God says, because you say, I'm going to be your servant, Lord. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to be like you. I'm going to do what you do. Teach me, Lord. Strengthen me, Lord. This is an altar call for everybody here. I'm not leaving anybody out. I'm not even going to give you an option. I'm just going to set you free. Then you just do with it whatever you want to do with it. I set you free from the powers of darkness. I set you free from every mind-blinding spirit. I open the prison doors. I tell you, come on out. Come on into this life. Get out of the deep, dark, moldy dungeon and pit that you've been living in. Step over here into the sunshine. Hallelujah. Woo! Breathe the fresh air of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Be filled with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Be filled right now with peace that passes understanding. Be filled right now with love divine. Be filled with every good thing. In Jesus' name. Everybody, will you stand with me? Hallelujah. Mondo serenea. People, just decide today. Decide today. Decide today. I want you to decide today that you are going to live in heaven. Decide today that your life has ceased to exist under your own power, and now you live in the kingdom of God. Go ahead. Decide today that all the doubt and misery and wavering and self-justifying, it's over. Today, you're going to start living in heaven from here on in. Couple people clapped. But now, well, why is it that you're an indecision? Why is it that you weren't willing to respond wholeheartedly and say yes? Why? When the invitation, when did it come from me? It came from the Lord Jesus Christ, who's speaking through me right now. Why would you hesitate? There's something wrong. You're holding on to doubt and unbelief. You're holding on to predicting that the future is going to be like the problems of your past, rather than believing for a new day. God brings a miracle of a new day. A miracle of a new day that comes because we're willing to believe and we're willing to simply obey Him. Is it going to demand change? Yes. Jesus is going to look at you and He's going to say, go sell all that you have, give it to the poor, and come follow me. You're going to have to quit living in worry and doubt and fear over the problems and the situation that you now, that has occupied you at this point. So I'm not going to live in pain and worry and fear anymore. I'm going to give it to the Lord. Whether I live or whether I die, I'm the Lord's. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm just going to live my life as a living sacrifice. Everything I do is going to be about you, Lord. Hallelujah. Everything's blessed. Everything's blessed. Somebody said, I can't believe it. He's got something special going on with God. He's either lying or he's got something special going on with God. Because he says everything about his life is blessed. You know what? Even the things that don't look blessed, I say they're blessed. See, it's a choice. It's a choice. I got a perception. My perception is God's perception, what he said in his word. I choose to believe what he said. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm taken care of. I'm well provided for. Hallelujah. I don't get stuck in some problem and start letting the problem tell me that it's my master and that it is truth and it is what I have to believe. What I have to believe is what God said. At the entrance of His Word, you get understanding. Now you have wisdom and insight to know what to do and how to respond to whatever it is you're going through. And you're going to respond according to what God said He would do for you, and what God said He's provided for you, and what God said He's going to bring to pass. That's your response. I'm not going to respond to some situation that's going to make me have doubt and unbelief and start doing something else, because then I'm mastered by the world. I'm mastered by demon power. I'm mastered by my own self-interest. You need to get in church. You need to start having a diet of the Word. Otherwise, you're going to be living by the mentality of the spirit of this world. You either live by the mentality of the Word, the light that the Word of God, the insight that the Word of God gives, or you live by the mentality and the insight that the world imposes. There is no neutral ground. And if you're not giving yourself to the Word of God, on a daily basis, every day, allowing the Word of God to quicken you, I tell you exactly where you're living. And that's why doubt and unbelief is able to develop your life to the crisis that it's in. But when you start living by the Word of God, you'll start living in a realm of faith. You start living in a realm of wisdom and insight. Hallelujah. And now what will happen is all the blessings of God and all the Father's purpose and all the Father's interest in doing through us will begin to be developed and merged in our life. We'll find ourselves being champions in a generation. We'll find ourselves being those who have right to stand there along with the mighty. It's a place of rejoicing. It's a place of the mighty. It's a place of giving thanks. Hallelujah. It's a place of believing God even when everything says no. Even when the wife is laughing. Saying, shall I now have pleasure? Now that I am old? And my Lord also being 100 years old. God named that child after her response, laughing. Laughter. Listen to me. Abraham didn't waver. He had many years to change his mind, change his disposition. There was times he said, Lord, let Ishmael live before you. I'm good with that. And Father says, no. At the time of life, I shall return unto you. Father, may we begin to understand what you've created and what you've made and developed and call it sacred and hold it sacred. The treasure, the riches that you've given to us in your word and in your promises, oh God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Father, I pray today that there won't be a single person standing in this place that somehow thinks that there's greater riches than your word. There won't be a single person here that would think that somehow there's greater wisdom and insight and purpose than the things that you've revealed in your word. That everybody will begin to rejoice that they get to live by your word. They get to live days of heaven upon the earth. Hallelujah. Let me just share something with you. My wife and I got married. I had a guitar. She had a VW. She had a bank account. I didn't. She had $300 in there, and God put miraculously 100 and something, 20 or 30 in there above that. And I was exceedingly thankful. And there were so many times in our lives early on that we had enough money to buy tortillas and milk, things for the kids. And I was exceedingly thankful. I was just so blessed. And we found ourselves in every situation just being so thankful, so blessed. Just because it's all about Jesus. Just so blessed. My affections aren't on anything else. I really, truly believe I could have lived in a cardboard box and been just so blessed. I believe I could have lived in anything, tent, under a tree, in a cave, and been so blessed because it's all about Jesus. The other day, Ann and I were standing in a place that the Lord has given to us to build a house in, to build a house at. We were standing there. We're just overwhelmed at looking at it. And suddenly, as I'm standing there looking at this beautiful place, it was last week, just in this amazingly beautiful place, the Lord spoke to me, said, see, because I had a dream. And in this dream, I was standing in the presence of the Lord. It's one of the times that I've actually been brought in the presence of the Lord. I was there. Whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. I was there. And I was on my knees before the Lord and said, Lord, what have I done wrong? And he turned to me almost like I was aggravating. I said, you haven't done anything wrong. And he went back to doing what he was doing. I said, Lord, why did you take my land away from me? And it was because of the crisis that we went through with the property we had up in Ramona doing a development. And it was all about the kingdom of God. We had no mentality of getting wealthy on our for ourselves. Because we had a lot of opportunities to become wealthy through it and not take any risk. It was all about, Lord, how can we take this thing all the way? And all, every bit of the finances go into the things that, you know, we had on our plate to do. We, I mean, we had major crusades lined up that God was putting together for us, and we were going to be able to fund them. Right to the, and the other things that the Lord laid in our hearts in our missions work. And I was standing there, and the Lord said, see? And I realized, this place that I'm standing in, was standing in last week, is a thousandfold greater than what I had. It's a thousandfold. See, he knew what he was going to do. I didn't know what he was going to do. I was at the crisis of the moment. I have learned that whatever state that I find myself in, to be exceedingly thankful because Father's got something better. I know it looks like I just got the best thing taken from me. Somehow I missed out. Somehow it got taken away. Somehow it got robbed. But no. Father's got plans. He wants to see if I'm going to continue to walk in the relationship with him. He's always asking me, how do you like the relationship now? Now what do you think about me? Am I still the good God? Am I still faithful? Do I still love you? Am I still on your side? Am I before you and behind you? Am I your exceeding shield and exceeding great reward? Well, but circumstance has a very loud voice and a very imposing emotion upon our lives. And it's right in our face, breathing its hot, nasty breath in our, you know, in our space. Are you with me? Are you with me? It's hard to ignore it. You got to turn. Look to Jesus. Just begin to praise him. Give thanks to him. Say, Father, he's so good to me. He's so good to me. You blessed me with salvation. You've redeemed me with your blood. You've written my name in your book. I'm kept by your power. I'm ready to be revealed. All I want is a heavenly blessing. All I want is that which is in you. Oh, thank you, Father God, that you brought us this far, that you sustained us. Too many mountains our feet have gone over. Too many rivers we have passed through. We find that he is so faithful. If you'll stand and prophesy, speaking his word, declaring the things which he's spoken, all of his promises and all of his blessings will be realized in your life. All of his promises and all of his blessings. All of his glory and all of his riches. He's called you and I to it. He's called us to his glory and virtue. That the eyes of your understanding may be opened, that you may understand and know the exceeding riches of his inheritance that he has in us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Just let faith well up in you. Let faith by the word of God begin to so overwhelm all of your emotions and thinking right now that you can't backslide into what you were in before. That said, there won't be slipping back and going back, that they'll be staying here, that you'll be able to take a place in this realm of the divine and having done all, stand right here in this place of divine power and authority. Hallelujah. Sutaramandeo. Sutaramosande Ishikia Nanomonsa Sutaraneasa. Hallelujah. Sikandolo Bosiritina Mosate Ashia Pukinea. Hallelujah. When you have the insights of God, the wisdom of God, you'll never see defeat. When you have the wisdom inside of God, you'll never see defeat. Wisdom and insight of God will bring a revelation that will cause you always to move in faith. Powerful, mountain-moving, earth-shaking, God encountering faith. Hallelujah. Gifts developing faith. Faith where nothing is impossible. I learned a long time ago, I cannot afford one moment of doubt. It's too costly. It's too costly. It's too expensive. cost months, sometimes even years, to deal with that one moment. I don't allow it. No doubts. I've learned a long time ago that what you do will be measured again to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And I'm not going to have nothing coming to me but blessings, I'm telling you right now. I'm not having anything coming to me but blessings. I've learned how to not be stupid. I've learned how to be smart, look in the mirror and say, shut up. You don't know what you're talking about. You do what God said do. You bless like God said bless. You love like God said love. You believe like God said believe. Come on. Woohoo! We are the people of the Lord. We are the people of the Lord. That's why we shout. We are the people of God. We the most blessed people on the face of the earth. We got more going on for us than anybody has going on for them. There's more with us than are with them any day of the week. God is on our side. Who can be against us? Amen. Hallelujah. He's blessed. Who can curse? Jesus. Woo! In Jesus' name, be blessed, be richly supplied in every good thing. In the name of Jesus, I wish above all and pray above all and believe above all that you'll prosper and that you'll be in health, that you'll know about living in divine health. I've been being stirred about that much more about living in divine protection against injury. Hallelujah. Not just health. I just keep getting promoted into another realm, you know. I've been living in divine health, not getting sick. I mean, there was a time in my life I got sick all the time. If it came around, I got it. I said, there's enough of this, and I got promoted by the wisdom of God into a place of divine health. Hallelujah. And a bully bull throwing me around the other day. I got protected. I only got one little scrape. I'm a knuckle. I was going, come on. The Lord's our protector. He's our provider. He's our perfecter. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know that Father's provided for you everything that you have need of? You need to start doing more so you have more needs. In his book. In your book, you might think you have more needs. In his book, you don't see many more needs than what you have being supplied. You get busy in the kingdom and say, hey, well, JJ's got more needs. We have to give him a bigger bank account. How are you listening to me? Hallelujah. God is faithful. He cannot lie. He's faithful as the sun is shining. So is provision. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kashiyaputa. I command a blessing on every one of you in the name of Jesus, every one of you. And I do it by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ in his stead, because that's what he's done. And today, you know, if you're standing there in his presence and you heard Jesus Christ himself saying to you, I command a blessing on you, you be sure of it. You be sure of it. And that certainty, you would have the blessing of it. You would have the prosperity of it. You would receive the miracle of it. So be certain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, sia roboya sio romongi ayeno mungishi aneotai. Every yoke broken. Every hindrance removed. Amen.